somewhat surprising item at a Swiss business named author Andrzej Sikorski's Princess of Cintra. Where can you purchase a lore accurate edition of Yennefer's famous lilac and gooseberry perfume? Welcome to Breakfast in Beauclair's Around the Table, a segment where we go around the Beauclair breakfast table with other Witcher content creators, sharing facts and tidbits about the production and real-life history, folklore, and culture behind an episode of Netflix's The Witcher. This week, we're diving into episode 105, Bottled Appetites.
Hey, this is Brett from Whispers of Oxenford. Jinns, or jinns, or genies, come from Arabian and Islamic folklore, most popularly known due to the hit Shaquille O'Neal joint Kazam. Oh, what's that? Nobody remembers that mid-90s bomb but me? Then probably the Disney movie Aladdin. Not the live-action one. Jinns are supernatural creatures that are neither good or evil, much like humans. While they existed before Islam, they are mentioned dozens of times in the Quran. While not inherently evil, those that act that way are known as ifrits, which make an appearance in The Fisherman and the Jinn from Scheherazade's 1001 Nights.
Hey, it's Lars from Witcherflix. Did you notice that almost every actor or actress with a speaking role living in Rinde, where Yennefer is staying, is a German native speaker? Lukas Engländer, who plays the elf Chiriaden, is from Austria. Joachim Paul Asberg, who plays the man asking Yennefer to help him with his sex problems, is German. Just like his character's wife, who is played by Anita Olatunji. And last but not least, there's Richard von Weiden, who plays the bald guard whose head explodes. You guessed it, he's also German. But what does it mean for the show lore? Is the local dialect in the city of Rinde in Redania German-sounding? Well, the word Rinde is German and means bark, as in tree bark. Or is even the whole dialect of Redania like this? Well, I hope we will see in season 2.
Hey, this is Cyprian from Berlin.
Yennefer and her ever so convincing charm. I am of course talking about the scene in episode 5 where we see Yen and Geralt meeting for the first time in a room full of half-naked people dancing trance-like, seemingly victims of a curse or a spell. You know what this reminds me of? Medieval dancing mania. Yeah, that really happened. Across Europe and across many centuries we have accounts of people, and I quote, dancing madly all day and all night until they collapse in ecstasy. Groups of participants could range from just one to a dozen up to tens of thousands at a time. The cause is to this day unknown, but at the time, witchcraft was of course considered a possibility.
Hey, this is Charlotte from Vengerberg Glamorai. This is the grand moment in the series where Geralt meets Yennefer for the first time. This is also the moment in the show when Yennefer's famous lilac and gooseberry perfume is mentioned. As you probably know, I'm really into perfume. The appeal of perfume is that it is at once ephemeral and empowering. It creates a shimmering, invisible armor that lingers in a room long after its wearer has gone, and infuses our imagination with a subtle power hinting at a hidden identity. Magic and perfume almost always walk hand in hand. Lilacs have a lore all their own. According to Greek mythology, it begins with a beautiful nymph named Syringa. Captivated by her beauty, Pan, the god of the forest, chases her through the woods, and frightened by him, she turns herself into an aromatic bush, the flower we now refer to as lilac. In the language of flowers, purple lilacs symbolize the first emotions of love. Gooseberries also have tales of their own. In England, it is said that babies are found under gooseberry bushes. To dream of the berries is a sign you will bear many children, and gooseberries generally served as a symbol of anticipation. Even Yennefer's nickname, Yen, has a hidden meaning. The word Yen means craving or longing. If you want to experience Yennefer's famous perfume yourself, check out my website at glamorai.com.
Hey, here's Carolina from Witcher Kitchen. Ciri in the series, after escaping from the besieged Cintra, had to hide her identity. That's why she introduced herself with the false name of Fiona. But have you ever wondered, what are the origins and what the story behind her original name? Sapkowski explains it in Historia y Fantastica publication. He revealed that name Ciri was based on the name of the jacket, quoting the author. While at same business in Switzerland, I was browsing my clients' pricing list with kids' jackets, which names were based on female ones. So, they were Isabel, Susan, Alice, Mabel. There was also Ciri, good one I thought, and I put in my notes. End of the quote. Yep, so Ciri is basically the name base of the jacket, simply as that.
Thanks for sharing breakfast with us in this installment of Around the Table. The Witcher universe has so much to uncover. Let us know in the comments below what you found interesting from today's segment and if you have something new to share with our Hansa about this episode. We'll see you after the next episode of Breakfast in Beauclair.